This conference will now be recorded.
Started.
So, yeah, so a very good morning to everyone. And we are today at a program called, which is like starting a Manav Club, right? So Manav Club is a initiative from Department of Biotechnology, Persistent NCCS and ICER, right? And then we have here Dr. Anupama Harshal, right? Who would be introducing us to the Manav activity and the Manav platform and things like that. Okay, the mainstay of this activity is about how to read scientific literature, right? So that is what we are here at. And then she will guide us into it. So before I introduce Dr. Anupama, I will request Dr. Honorable Principal Dr. Atmaram Pawar sir to introduce our college in brief, right, to the audience. Of course, like, audience is basically our students, so they don't need any introduction as such, but Dr. Anupama may need some introduction. So please, Dr. Pawar.
Yeah, so welcome to this Punakaja Pharmacy, the activity which is related to the Manav group event. And I feel very happy to associate with this Manav Activity Human Utters Initiative, which is initiated by the big authorities like Department of Biotechnology and NCCS and ICER, and co-founded by the Persistent. It is a very good event for us. So always we work for such events and we participate. So for that, I welcome the Anupama Harshal Madam for this to our college and to Bharati Vidyapeeth online. So this is the Bharati Vidyapeeth, which is established on the 10th May 1964 by Honorable Dr. Patangrauji Kadam. And at present, this is the very big institute at a national level, having 180 plus institutes from school to the postdoctorate. Plus, its main point is, as yesterday only we celebrated our 26th, the foundation day of the Bharati Vidyapeeth, deemed to be university. The very big thing in this is that when Dr. Patangrauji Kadam started this Bharati Vidyapeeth in 1964, at the age of his 19 years, so just after completion of 10th or the 11th, one can say. So at that time, he dreamed to have this university. And really, we are happy that yesterday we celebrated this 26th, the foundation day of that Bharati Vidyapeeth, which is dreamed by the Honorable Patangrauji Kadam. And definitely, Bharati Vidyapeeth have the very good motive that social transformation through dynamic education. Our aim is not just to have the component of only education, but we see that the education should transform the social. It is fulfilling the social needs. And at the quality of education, so our university is ranked three times, awarded or accredited by the NAC three times with the A+ grade. And at present, we have the very good highest grade in the NAC category. We are always in the NRIA ranking. What it means is our university is ranked as A category, university by MHRD also. This is for the university, which is initiated by Dr. Patangrauji Kadam, initially as Vidyapeeth, and now it is the full-fledged university having 29 units under it. So regarding the college, we are the constituent of Bharati Vidyapeeth from 2000. But before that, we were the part, or we are the pioneer college in this region of Pune to provide the quality education in the pharmacy. And for many courses, we are the always first to start that course, to establish that course. And then the many other colleges follow our policy or the success what we give. So main thing of this PCP is, okay, academics, we have the very good standards of academics. But Honorable Dr. Shivaji Rauji Kadam, who was at present Chancellor of Bharati Vidyapeeth, deemed to be university, and who was initially a principal for 25 years, he thought research is the main component for any education. And just after 1 year, in 1982 only, he started the polymer science research in our college in collaboration with the NCA. So our research environment is as good as parallel with our college establishment or the academics. So after that, we started the formal PG course from 1986 and the PhD, formal PhD in pharmacy from 1990. So we have the very good the research laboratory of 45,000 square feet, having more than 13 crore rupees equipment like LCMS, MS, GCMS, MS, all nano sizer, a number of equipments we have. We have the very good animal house also. So our faculty members are almost all are research oriented, who published more than 1100 international publications, around 300 national publications, and three faculty of our college are listed under 2% top scientists at a global level also. So in the research, we are have the very good publications. At the same time, we are catering the needs of the industry, pharma industry, ayurvedic industry, cosmetic industry by different means. So these means are, we have the PTL laboratories or food testing laboratories for checking the quality of the medicament, food products, cosmetic products. At the same time, so we are providing the consultancy for many nearby the pharma, cosmetics and herbal industries also. And from last year, we are now in these innovations, incubations, skill developments. We have the formal skill PCP as the one platform for the skill development, under which we also received one national level hackathon award for development of one system for the water purification. So in this way, we are happy to associate always with the Mano, because we are doing the research. So it may be a good research, but with help of the Mano, with help of the support of Anupama Madam, so definitely this will benefit our the scientific community of the PCP. And I thanks and welcome you all. So including today's the main the key speaker Anupama Harshal, our vice principals Dr. Rao, Dr. Kokarkar, and the today's the coordinator Dr. Abhay Harsulkar. So all the best for this function, and thanks.
Okay, thank you, sir. And we welcome our two vice principals, Dr. Varsha Gokharkar and Dr. Rao Madam, on this occasion also. Okay. So with this, I will take another 2-3 minutes to introduce our speaker today, and then we will start our session. Okay, so Dr. Anupama Harshal has a versatile biodata, right? So one of the very versatile biodata that I have seen ever. In this fact is that, okay, our other skills, right, are molecular biology, cell culture, protein purification, that is what listed into other skills. Her skills here are like, she, of course, she has a long teaching experience, about 18 plus years, and she has a expertise in science communication and public engagement. So this is something, a different field. She worked as a consultant at ICER, right, and was a visiting professor at of Pharma Biotech in ICT, that is Mumbai. Then she was also visiting professor of biotechnology in Xavier College. And then she has a specialization in pedagogy and content. That is something, another very interesting part that what we also do here in our college. And then she has taken many pedagogy workshops at state level, school levels, and things like that. She also has a science outreach experience. These are something, another different term that we are coming across. So it's like a science outreach expertise that she have. So, and then she's also researched with pedagogy tools. That is also another thing that she is like a trainer. And who else other than her could be the best person to talk about how to read scientific literature, right? So that is like a, that is a, that's a good thing, that of course, like we all, lots of scientific papers coming up and things like that, right? how to read is a different thing. And then this technique that we and exploit it by our students, and then we use for the Mano platform to use, right? So I think reading paper and then extracting the information, then putting it into Mano Atlas is the core of this club activity. We are going to start this club activity, and this is one such program. There may be some other programs into this kind of. Please mute your microphones. Right. Over to Dr. Anupa Harshal now, and then she can talk about two important topics: how to read scientific literature and introduction to Mano, the Human Atlas Initiative. Over to you, Dr.
Thank you so much, Abhay sir. Thank you, Atmaram sir. Thank you to the entire staff and management at Pune Pharmacy College. I am very impressed that you have got A+ for three cycles. As an academician, I completely appreciate, because I know what kind of compliance NAC needs. So a real round of applause for your college, and congratulations to the entire team. With that backdrop, I would like to start today. With your permission, can I mute everybody? Is that okay? Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
I'll be starting on the backdrop of how to read scientific literature and an introduction to Manav, the Human Atlas Initiative. So what we'll try and do is I'll try and begin on the backdrop of what is information versus what is knowledge. Okay. So when we try and understand what is information, we know that we are all surrounded by meaningful content. Now this could be related to science and technology. It could be related to gadgets. It could be related to therapeutics. It could be related to the performing arts. It could be related holistically or just general administration. So then your next question would be, what is knowledge? Yes, if this is information, then what is knowledge? So whenever an expert in a particular field, whenever an expert or an experienced person in that field critically distills out specific points, then that becomes knowledge. So students, where do you get your knowledge from? You get your knowledge from your teachers. You get your knowledge from your research guides. You get your knowledge from your mentors. And you get knowledge from textbooks. Now, please remember, many a times these textbooks are not updated, just till all information yesterday. So sometimes you may find, because the internet is updated regularly, you may find that something is amiss. But otherwise, all the information that we have, that goes in terms of getting critically distilled and put into textbooks is actually updated on a very regular basis. So I want you to remember this subtle difference between information and knowledge. Now, before I go ahead, let me tell you, students, I'm going to be interacting with you. So I want you to use the chat window and be ready with a pen and paper, because I'm going to be asking you with a lot of questions. So where do you get your information from? I'm sure the answers are going to be many. Newspapers, social media handles, public databases. And right now, our situation is like that of the child, who's holding the phone. We're waiting for some good news that yes, the pandemic has, I was just going through the data for Maharashtra, that for the past 3-4 days, the number has remained constant. So we're just hoping that it peaks and plateaus, and then the numbers start going down. So our situation is like that. We're waiting for some information on the phone, right? Presently, however, you will find that if you're going to post something on Facebook or you're going to send something in WhatsApp, government opinion actually banned any COVID-related information to be transmitted on the phone. Okay, now this should tell you, 1 second, somebody's audio is on, so I will just try and put everybody at mute here. Okay, so I hope this is good now, because I've just put everybody on mute. Yeah, so what happens is, if that information that we're sharing is not valid, if it has not been validated, if it doesn't have any evidence, then it becomes a rumor. I'm sure we all remember rumors like high temperature will inactivate the virus, low temperature will inactivate the virus, if you eat this, it will inactivate the virus. But we know that there was not enough evidence for it. And then what happens, this circulates in the population and everybody starts believing in it. So to avoid a situation like that, the government of India wants you to go to well-curated sites, those of WHO, CDC, India Biosciences, ICMR, and more. Okay. So I hope you can get the message here that information is not knowledge. Experience is knowledge. and all the rest falls under the domain of being called as information. Okay, so when you use a public database like Google, what's missing? Whenever we're doing some work, the first thing that we do is go to these public databases like Google, Wikipedia, and check out something, right? So what's missing in Google? Well, curation. What is the meaning of curation? Curation essentially means selection of accurate content. So have you ever seen that whenever you order something online, you get, you know, in your inbox, there are more advertisements for the same or similar message? Yes, have you seen that? Let me give you a more specific example. So I want to buy a mobile phone and I go to Google. And you know what Google does? Google gives me several vendor sites. And it also gives me several blogs. Now, in these blogs, I get information about which phone is good, what is the storage capacity, what camera works, and what are the features, and so on. But when I go to the vendor sites, it gives me several filters. And what are those filters? Those filters are what is the price of the phone I want to buy, what is the camera resolution I'm looking at, what is the storage capacity I need, and so. When I define these filters, I'm able to make a choice for the purchase of a phone which fits in my budget and has the requisite features. So, what is the definition of curation? The selection, organization, and presentation of online content, merchandise, information, typically using professional or expert knowledge. I hope you will understand. Selection, organization, and presentation, typically using professional or expert knowledge. Okay. So, what then is data curation? As an academician, as a scientist, as a teacher, it is my duty to tell you that where are there avenues for you as a career opportunity. So there are fields like academia, there are fields like research and development, there are fields like packaging, there are also fields like making content, and there are fields like data science. So many of you will become data scientists. So what is this field? What is it talking about? What is the necessary skill set that you need to pick up in this course so that you can become a good data scientist? Well, you may end up doing data wrangling, data mining, or data curation. So data curation is the active and ongoing management of data through its life cycle of interest and usefulness to scholarship, science, and education. This includes appraisal, selection, representation, organization of these data for access and use over time. So I hope you're ready. And my first question goes to you as follows. Please use the chat window to give me the answer. Please also remember there is no penalty for a wrong answer. I just want you to get thinking. Have you heard of the term peer review? Have you heard of the term peer review? And do you think peer review is a form of curation in science? Have you heard of the term peer review? And do you think peer review is a form of curation in science? So students, I want you to use the chat window and tell me. Okay, so I have the first answer from Anant, Karan, Ume. Very good. So they're saying, yes, I think they've heard of the term peer review. And do you think it is similar to curation? Do you think it has any connection with curation? Anybody? Thank you, Soumi. So I'm keeping your answer streaming here because I want you to think and answer back. Thank you, Ryan. Thank you, Anand. Thank you so much. You can keep sending me those answers. That really kind of motivates me. So my question was, have you heard of the term peer review? And do you think peer review is something which is similar to curation in science? Okay. As promised, I told you every new word that I will be using, I will clarify during the course of my lecture. So here we go. So what is curation? Curation is when you take your manuscript. Thank you, Srishti, Suman, Pradeep, Karan. Thank you for those answers, Shakuntala. I'm continuously streaming the answers. And teachers, you should be very proud that your students are giving answers and they also know the content. So whenever you write a manuscript, you write a chapter, you write some content and you send it to a publishing house, the publishing house sends it to an expert. Now, this expert may be a molecular biologist, maybe somebody who is doing pharmacy, maybe somebody who is doing pharmacodynamics, maybe somebody who is doing bioinformatics, and they go through all your data and ensure that the data is valid enough to be released in the public domain. Okay, so Maitri, Abhijit, Sri, Shakuntala, I hope you vibe with that answer. So indeed, peer review is a form of curation in science. So why is curation important? Well, curation is important because it helps you evaluate the quality of scientific data. It could also ensure better access to the best scientific data. Okay, so I hope students, you've understood what is curation. You also have been able to match it with peer review and also understand why curation is important. So what about Wikipedia? Do you think Wikipedia is curated? And if Wikipedia is curated, by whom is it curated? Well, the graphic says it all. Thank you, Anand. Anand says Wikipedia is not curated. Truly, Wikipedia is not curated because Wikipedia can be edited by anyone from anywhere. Okay. And do you think there's a problem with this? Yes. Thank you, Gauri. Thank you, Ritika. So what happens is I could be a certified content writer for Wikipedia, but I may not be a pharmacist. I may not be, an expert mathematician, but nevertheless, I'm writing content. So therefore, this content that I'm writing there for Wikipedia cannot be trusted because I'm not an expert on it. And please don't believe everything that I'm saying, but I'm going to give you evidence for wherever I have not got enough to say. So this is the Wiki disclaimer, which we got from their desk. And I hope you can see point number 6, which clearly says that we do not expect you to trust us. And of course, there are more also, but this is from the Wiki desk. So the next time you use Wiki, please understand that it's got content which we cannot trust. So the quality may vary from time to time and from article to article. Now, because Wikipedia can be edited by anyone at any time, the articles may be prone to errors. As a result, what happens? The information cannot be trusted. But please wait, there is some help. There are always helpful, important links at the end of each article which are provided, which you can refer to. Okay, so always remember, I'm leaving this as an open-ended question for you, whether you should be using or getting your scientific information from public databases like Google and Wikipedia. So what do you think? Would Albert Einstein use Wikipedia? What do scientists use? Where do major breakthroughs and minor breakthroughs in science get published? Well, the answer is scientific journals. So I have taken a few journals here for your reference, and I'm sure your college. Thank you, Sumit. Sumit says peer review is one form to maintain quality in journals and in science. So I have a few journals here which I have taken: Cell, Nature, Science. And this is also to tell you that there are journals in other subjects. Okay. And of particular reference here is the Indian Journal of Medical Research, which has been put here, that is established in 1913. Now, the purpose of putting this in my slide deck is to tell you that while as a country we have a culture of research and development, if you want to make a place for yourself in basic science, applied science, or allied sciences, you must be very well read to make an educated opinion. Okay, so I have taken a few papers here from CRISPR, and it's one of my favorite subjects. Obviously, it's a moment in time and a moment of pride because Dr. Charpentier and Dr. Dodna have received the Nobel Prize in October 2020 for their discovery of CRISPR. Now, why I have put it here is to tell you that while a Financial Times article announces the arrival of CRISPR as a treatment protocol for beta thalassemia and sickle cell anemia, if you want to know more about what techniques were used, what protocols were used, what experiments were designed, what animal models were used, then the newspaper article is of no help. For that, you need to go back and read all. Thank you, Suman. Suman says CRISPR is also my favorite topic. Thank you so much. So if you want to get information related to all the science and technology involved there, then the newspaper article is of no help to you. You have to go back and read the original research articles to get information. Okay, so I hope you will understand. For those of you who are not very well aware, CRISPR is a large genome editing technology. Okay, like you make an edit, copy and paste. So you cut out a disease gene, you put a normal gene there, and the person can lead an absolutely healthy life without having any trace of the disease. So which should be your go-to databases? I think somebody in the audience has already replied. So a huge round of applause for you. Your go-to databases should be PubMed, Google Scholar, Scopus, and Web of Science. Now, these are all depending on the kind of accessibility given to you by your school or your college library. Okay? Many times it becomes very difficult for us to get access to these engines. So you can always request your library to give you a routing. That means some address or some link by ways of which you can access your entire library. Okay? Now, this is how the PubMed webpage looks like. That's the address and the scan QR code. So I hope all of you are with me to see with an example of how to search for a literature paper. So we are starting from scratch. So this is how the PubMed homepage looks like. And this is a window here. Now, what should I put in this window? I don't want to make it complicated for you, right? Because Einstein once said, if it ain't simple, I don't want to learn. So we will study with an example of how to get this information. So here, what do I put? Should I put a keyword? Should I put the name of a disease? Should I put the name of a term, the name of a spike protein? Whatever is my question, I should put that here in the search window, and that becomes my keyword. So let's see that with an example. So I here put protein kinase C as an example, and I hope you can see I have some thousands of results, and it is going to be impossible for me to go through those results. In the next slide, I want you to see when I put protein kinase C on Google, it is also listing Wikipedia as one of the sources. So students, I again leave it open-ended to you whether you should be using Wikipedia and Google to get your scientific references. Okay, now when I type protein kinase C in Google Scholar, it gives me the ease of getting references in the last 10 years or the last 20 years, 30 years, and so on. Okay, so this is something that it gives me a timeline help that really helps me filter down the references, and also something called as narrowing down my searches. Okay, so if I want to reduce the number of references and I want those specific references, then I say protein kinase C and tumor suppressor. So here I'm looking for some correlation between protein kinase C and tumor suppressor. I now have 869 results. I'm sure you'll agree, even 869 is too much for me to go through. Okay, so I put the name of an author. Now, when I put the name of the author, I have 9 results. And I'm sure all of you will agree that 9 papers are quite easy to read for a single person, right? Now, many a times I may not remember the full name. Like I hope you could see, many people find it a little difficult to pronounce my surname, Badolikar. So they may not remember my surname, but they may just remember Anupma, Anupma HW. So just the name or the partial name or even the author affiliation, like I said Pune. Okay, so that will help you get all the publications of that particular scientist. So here is just to give you an idea that even if we change the name of the author here, we're still able to get the same 9 results. I hope you are with me that these are live searches, and therefore, you know, we've just taken pictures, and therefore this is almost real for you to believe. Now, all of us are very different, right? Somebody may use a connector like and, somebody may use a comma, and somebody may use or, right? Which means Rashi, I'm noting down your question. I will answer back to you towards the end, okay? So we're all very different. So please see, irrespective of the connector you have used, you can still get the same 9 searches, okay? Thank you, Ritik, for giving me that answer. So what if I wanted to know more about diabetes mellitus? The occurrence of diabetes mellitus is in Pune versus that in Mumbai, or Trivandrum versus that in Chennai, right? So whatever is my criteria, I can define that and get that. I can also get information about a particular author, where I can type the name of the author or his lab affiliation, and then get to know all the publications about that particular author. Okay, which takes me to which are the 4 classes of scientific literature. They are research articles, review articles, commentary, and medical case reports. So today's talk, we will focus only on research articles and review articles. The commentary and medical case reports, we will cover it some other time. So here goes my next question. My question to you is as follows. Have you heard of the term review article? Have you heard of the term review article? Wait, my question is not over yet. In a review article, is it reporting the work done by one group of authors, or does it report the work done by many authors, by many scientists? Is it reporting the work done by one group of scientists or by many group of scientists? So I can see the answer, Shlok, Digambar, Andita, Anvita, Srishti, Preeti, thank you so much. Thanks, I could take a water break for that. Thank you so much. Yes, so I can see the answer streaming that a review paper has work published by, is reporting the work done by many scientists. Thank you so much for those answers. Well, you can keep streaming your answers, absolutely not an issue. I'm going to keep leaving, reading them. But let me tell you what a review article is. A review article is something that is like a club of research articles. I hope you can see the image. Now, in a review article, what happens is one particular set of authors is actually writing the paper or the review piece, right? So it tells you how this person or persons views all the current literature in the field. Okay, now this could be a thumbs up or it could be a thumbs down. So you have to understand that it is essentially seeing all those papers through this person's point of view, right? So a review article is essentially an opinion piece. Now, many a times it may be biased and many a times it may not be biased, but I will be coming to this a little later. So students, what if you could read many research articles and make connections between them? Do you think you will enjoy an activity like that? I will be coming back to this, like I said. Okay, which brings us to the main body of a research article, which is the title, the abstract, the introduction, materials and methods, results, discussion, conclusion, and references. Yes, thank you, Anuja. I will be taking your answer a little later because I'm going to be asking you that as a question. Yes. So we have the title here and the abstract. Thank you, Aditi. So the title essentially is a combination of words. I hope you can see it is our first encounter, right? It is our first encounter of what that Netflix series is or what that Netflix, movie is about or what that research paper is all about. An abstract, on the other hand, is a 150 to 250 word summary, right? But it is essentially the trailer of the paper. Now, you have to remember that many a times we see the trailer of a movie and the trailer is amazing. But what happens when we go and see the movie? The movie doesn't look so good. Similarly, the abstract for many research papers may be very impressive, but the paper may not look so good. So I leave it up to you to decide what is going to be your criteria for selection of a research article, which I'm going to ask you in a few minutes from now. So this is the reference paper that I'm going to be using, which is from Dr. Nagaraj Balasubramanian's lab. His lab is the Cell Adhesion Lab at ICER Pune. So if you are interested in studying CAM-JAMS, which is cell adhesion molecules and junction adhesion molecules, do visit the ICER Pune website, check out what his lab is working on, and see if it interests you for a master's PhD program or a postdoctoral fellowship or a research fellowship on any of the projects that he has a grant for or for any other scientist. Okay, this is the reference paper that I will be using today for my talk. So the title generally summarizes the main idea of the research paper. It briefly describes the study. Read the title carefully and ask yourself, what do I understand, or do I really understand anything from the paper? Yes, the abstract, I said, is the trailer of the paper. So it clearly states the hypothesis, goal, or aim of the study. It provides a brief overview of the methods and results. It summarizes the key results, and it provides short conclusion. So make notes of whatever you understand and ask yourself, why do I want to read this paper further? Or do I want to really read this paper further? Which takes us to the introduction. I'm sure all of you will agree with experience, or if you've not read, you will learn it with experience, that the introduction is very long. It has so many names, it has so many discoveries, it has so many terminology. So it generally tends to, you know, bog you down. It makes you kind of feel a little bored or very tired, right? So how do we navigate in the introduction? So the introduction in many journals is structured, while in many other journals, it is not so structured. What I want you to remember here is that it provides a background of the topic. It contains some details about previously published studies on the same topic. It highlights important missing information. It explains why the present study was conducted. It may or may not provide an overall approach, but it sets a goal, aim, or hypothesis along with possible objectives for the study. Okay, so whenever you read the introduction, try and make a summary of the background in a few sentences for yourself. Why? If you are discussing this with your guide, with your teacher, with your mentor, yes, if there is a new protocol in this paper, if there is a new method, if there is a new chemical that is used, or a new perspective, instead of saying, oh, I had read this paper and this paper had this, yes, if you have a summary, you know that for this particular reference, you need to go to this paper. These were the authors and these were their findings, okay? So always try to summarize the background in a few sentences for your own references. So what did the experiments, what did the scientists do to carry out that particular study? What was needed to carry out these experiments? This is a list of reagents, the chemicals used, the antibodies used, the cell lines, whether they were HeLa cell lines, whether they were, disease-specific B16 melanoma cell lines, and so on. What animals were used? Were they mice? Were they rats? Were they guinea pigs? And of course, human subjects. Students, I want you to make a note here. I'm sure you have an ethics committee or a research committee in your college. But whenever you are carrying out even a questionnaire-based study where you engage human subjects, you know, asking basic subject questions like, are you aware about breast cancer? Which shampoo do you use? And things like that. Even then, always remember, you should always take their consent. If you want to publish this work, you should have a consent of people who have said yes to participate in your study. Also remember, with consent comes responsibility. So while you can say after the study, 250 people answered this, 150 said this, you can never reveal the name of the person and his choice in the public domain. It is offensive to do that. Okay, so I hope you will remember this. So what better than going through some examples for us to understand how materials and methods are actually written. So here you will see fibronectin was purchased from Sigma. The catalog number for each one of these has been given, so that if you want to repeat this experiment in your college, then you can actually get the same or similar results, which means that anybody can perform this experiment if we have provided the basic information of how it was carried out, what conditions and what raw materials were used for the same. What if I was using a biological material? So here I'm using a GFP tag plasmid, right? Even in that case, I hope you can see they have clearly written the name of the scientist, the name of the lab from which it has been procured, so that if you want that particular molecule, you can write to them and get it from them, okay? So what were the techniques that were used in the paper? Each technique will have the following details: the dosage, concentration of reagents, drugs, a detailed description of the methodology on how this experiment was performed. Yes, other details like sample sizes, controls, statistical analysis, or data analysis. So let's see this with an example. So your cells were labeled with the different material, and they were fixed with 3.5% PFA at room temperature for a particular 15 minutes time interval. Now, I hope you can see 0.2 micrometer cross sections were taken, and you know, Z-stats, object analysis, whatever was carried out has been clearly mentioned here in the materials and methods. In this case, mouse embryonic fibroblasts have been cultivated in Dolbeco's modified eagle medium with 5% fetal bovine serum. Now, I hope you can see that during the course of the experiment, they have used 10% fetal bovine serum, 5% CO2 incubator, and they have also used a low serum and a no serum concentration. Now, no serum is understood, but low serum has been clearly defined as 0.2% FPS. Okay, so what may be low temperature for you in Pune may not be the low temperature for me in Bombay or in Trivandrum or in Dehradun. So whenever you are writing a particular method or a protocol, even the minutest details should be mentioned or made note of. Okay, so I'm sure by now you're wondering, why am I telling you all this? So my question to you is as follows: do you think it's important to have reproducibility when you are carrying out experiments or studies in science, or it is okay that we have got it in ICER Pune, if it doesn't happen anywhere else it is okay? So do you think reproducibility is an important criteria? Yes, I'm very happy. The answer is streaming yes, which builds a lot of confidence that yes, there is a very high integrity, and reproducibility is a very important parameter in discoveries or carrying out science. Thank you, Prasad. Thank you, Anuja, Ritika, Rohit, Shri, just about all of you for, immediately answering that. And I will tell you why. Thank you, Digambar, Priyanka, Priya, Suman, Zahabia. So, the whole purpose of asking this question was, I hope you can see this, picture here. So there is a lady here who is holding the flask, and she's not sure if she should hold the flask at 37 degrees Celsius or she should incubate it at 37 degrees. She's holding here the flask at an angle from the base of the lab. Now, many a times we are in that situation, right? Because somebody has written it hold at 37, but we don't know whether it is referring to temperature or whether it is referring to an angle. With this, I'd like to take the opportunity to introduce a very important learning resource, which is Journal of Visualized Experiments. Yes, you heard it right, but you got it wrong. This is not a journal where you will find research papers, but you will find video scrolls of pathbreaking experiments, whether it is hybridization, whether it is antibody production, whether it is CRISPR. You will get exact video for, video scrolls. That means exactly how the experiment was carried out. Now, I can request this to your college that, your library can get access to it, and you can have your master's or your PhD students go through this site, get limited access. As a student also, if you can write a polite mail, they will allow you to access this site for a week. Now, it becomes amazing to see what is a robotic PCR, how to do a count in 10 microliters of the cells, how different vaccines are produced, how mapping is done, how conjugation is carried out. You'll be amazed at how these videos have been kept there for you. Another important point, again, many of you will be making a career joining such places to develop content. And I'm sure you understand that you need to have your science and concepts very strongly, imbibed and ingrained in you, so that you can, do justice to your job profile here. So In the results, you will have a statement of, yes, I'm going to tell you that, Darshan. Just give me 5 minutes and I'm just coming to that slide. Thank you. Thank you for that request. So in the results section, we will have a statement of what was found after conducting the experiment. So the concentration of protein A was higher than that of protein B. The tumor volume of the test was smaller than that of the control, right? So whatever was your finding after the experiment, that you will be reporting in the results. Read each section along with the respective figure and table. Does the result section answer all the questions is something that you should ask yourself. So what do you expect to see in results? Well, different kind of data. What kind of data depends on the kind of study. The data may vary. Should I be able to understand all of the data? Well, the answer is no, you will not be able to understand all the data. What if I do not understand all the data? The answer is read more papers. That's what scientists do. So let me tell you my example. When I'm reading a particular high-end, high-impact factor journal, research paper, then to understand that one paper, I end up reading 4 more research papers. That is the only way you're going to be able to navigate. But never get demoralized when you're reading a research paper. Many a times you will just understand a word, or you will just understand a terminology, or you will just understand a model system. It's perfectly okay. Even if you're able to take just 10% from reading of a research paper, you have achieved your target. Okay, so I already have a request from few of your students. So we will be going through a few results and seeing how results look like, right? So this is a microscopy image slide where you can see the cells have been labeled and you can see the scale 5 micrometers. Now what we will do is, students, I request you not to focus on the science. Let's just look at the overall profile of how results look like and how they are different. So this is the scale. And of course, this is microtubule and actin and centrosome pictures showing the middle plane, upper plane, and so on. In this slide, you can see qualitative and quantitative expression both having been put together. In the qualitative expression, you can see the protein profiles which have been put in comparison with the standard Western blots. The Western blot bands have been given their molecular weights and their names are given here. In the quantitative expression, however, I want you to see that there is a clear difference between SA and SUSP for the expression of a particular protein. But wait, did you just believe me? Never do that. Always look for the star sign or asterisk sign, which will tell you that yes, indeed, there is a marked difference between these two. Otherwise, you will be getting carried away by just the content. So it has to always be analyzed. Okay, so in this, just 1 second. I think my screen sharing has just paused. Yeah. I hope you can see my screen, all of you. Yeah, okay. So I hope you could see that whenever you're looking at the difference between two levels, always try and look for the star or the asterisk sign so that you can see that yes, the data has been analyzed and only then you should accept it. Okay, moving ahead. This is again another microscopic image, but it has been coupled with the quantitative data. Now in this case, again, you can see that there is a clear difference between the CNT and the FNB. In the microscopic observation, you can see there is 1.5 times magnification. And again, the scale 4 micrometers has been given here with proper labelings of the treatment and the starting material or the cell type that you have used. Okay. In this case, CNT says N equals to 34, which means the number of samples that were analyzed under this category or the number of sets that were performed in this treatment set. Okay. So always look for these standard minute bars that are there in a particular graph so that when you're reading that paper, your confidence in that data set is very high. Okay. This is a schematic method of giving the result. So there are no tables here. There are no big numbers, but I'm sure you can see that because of the treatment to non-adherent and re-adherent cells, you can clearly make out that there was a promotion of Golgi function, a reduction of Golgi function and basal level Golgi function. So this is called a schematic method of representing the results. Now, what happens is as we go ahead, this is a scientific illustration. So instead of the author saying take 10 to the power 8 cells, take the left shank of the mouse, inject the cells, raise the tumor, they have also given it Anand, there is a question. I will answer that question. I'll just go back to that slide. Let me just finish this slide. So here, this is a scientific illustration or a protocol validation. So what happens is you inject the cells, raise the tumor, salvage the tumor and sacrifice the mice. Yes, which means that in addition to what you have given in writing, you have also given a scheme so that the author has more confidence when they're performing those experiments. I'm just going back to my last slide. I think there was a question there. Yes. Please remember that in many papers, they describe the level of significance. Okay. So significance is 1 star, high significance is 2, and very high significance is 3. This is typically done by the authors themselves. Okay. That is why you will see that in one of the bars, there was just 1 star. And in the second or the third diagram, there are 3 stars. Okay. So this is defined by the authors in terms of level of significance. So I hope I have answered your question there. Yes. This is mouse tumor data. Now, in this case, you can see you have real-time mice scans. You have the tumors that have been excised. You have the day 0, day 5, and day 12 images. And of course, you have the quantitative expression here, which clearly shows, you know, the different levels. So I'm just showing you all these results for you to have an idea of how results actually look like when you are going to be seeing that in a research paper. Now, moving ahead, this is patient data. I hope you can see here, there are no images, there are no photographs, there are only dots. Each one of these dots is representing the IgG level of the patient in response to this particular study. So please be ready, you know, where, okay, again, there was a question. I will just look for the question and then come back to you. So each one of these is actually going to be telling you that this was the level. And also this is to tell you that this is not a Y equal to MX plus C graph. So there are at least about, 200 ways in which data can be represented. This is called as the Gaussian way. Yes, because in school, in college, we are only taught Y equal to MX plus C. But there are more than 200 ways by which data can be represented. And that's also a very, very, interesting domain for study. I think there is a very dear friend in LCL, Dr. Narlikar's daughter. I'm not remembering her first name. She had taken a session for us teachers. And how nicely she taught us this, you know, because I thought graphs could only be represented by the straight line graph, because as a biochemist, you are always following the Michaelis-Menten equation. But nevertheless, it's an eye opener that depending on the data sets, depending on the variability, depending on the kind of data you have, there are different ways of representation. So please excuse my ignorance for this also. So as a teacher, I always try to tell you that there is more to this, and it's a very interesting domain of study. There is, of course, more specialized data, which is proteomics data. And there is even more specialized data, which is genomics data. So I'm just going to be, taking a break for a minute and, showing you this. Just give me 1 minute. So I'm showing you some relevant data, which is, okay, I hope you can see this data. I hope you can see my screen. Okay, so here, since you're a pharmacy college, I thought it would be, good for you to see something that vibes with your content. So I hope you can see here, this is a pharmacokinetics and a pharmacodynamics data of 2 drugs, okay? So this is how you're representing your content. You are finding out the TED50 value of those 2 drugs, and you can see them in 2 different colors here. In the next slide, of course, you can see, the median doses, which is reflecting the LD50, ED50, and the TED50 values, which is clearly indicated here for the percentage of individuals responding to this dose versus the dose concentration. Okay, so I just thought it would be good for you to, have relevant material with reference to your content that is being shared. So ask yourself, are the results sufficient to prove the aim, goal, or hypothesis of the study? That's very relevant, right? You started with the paper. It had an aim. It had an objective. So ask yourself, are the results aligned to that aim? Is it in sync? Or did the aim have some other tangent and the results came in some other line? So that's very important in the discussion. So why was the concentration of protein A higher than that of protein B? Why was the volume of the tumor in the test smaller? That means your drug, your formulation, your bioactive compound, or your extract has shown some effect on the progression of the tumor, which is why the control tumor, which has the placebo, is big, while the test tumor, which has got the active moiety, has become small, which means that the tumor has not progressed. And this is what you will interpret from the obtained results, which you just mentioned as a statement. Okay. Comparison of results with previously published studies, strengths and limitations of the study, and future implications if there are for the study. Okay. Now, what I want to tell you here is that many papers will, go ahead in the discussion and then discuss what you have got in your results. You explain that in the discussion and then you conclude if you get enough evidence for conclusion. Now, many papers may not have this section. Okay, so what you have to remember is it is a summary of obtained results. Now, many a time students, what happens? We are doing a project and we don't get results. And you know what happens? We get demoralized. We go and tell our guide, sir, do I have to write a report? Yes, completely. Sometimes you shy away, not even showing up for your mentor. Please never do that. Even if you didn't get results, this was a thumb rule that I learned as a teacher. And believe me, I have been a successful teacher. I will share my story with you. That even if you didn't get a result, please write a report. Discuss with your guide. What could have gone wrong in the hypothesis you postulated? What could have gone wrong in the questions you asked? What could have gone wrong in the protocol you selected or the model system you selected? Maybe your lab didn't have a particular chemical. Maybe your lab didn't have a particular instrument, as a result of which you could not get results, right? What will happen is when you do this introspection, learning will happen. And when you submit this report, somebody else will, you know, get help when they want to go through that pathway. And believe me, I had students who didn't get, results for their honors program. One full 18 months they spent on the project and they came back and they gave me a report. And both of them are doing postdoctoral fellowship at Yale. So never, never, ever get demoralized. In fact, even when they came back and asked me, will you write a recommendation letter for me? I said, of course, I will write a recommendation for you. Because they did whatever they did to the best of their ability. Okay, some conditions failed and therefore never take it as a personal defeat. Okay, always learn from it and go ahead. So that was my, slight note here. So students, I want you to use the chat window and now tell me, you are a very learned audience, which, you know, with my inbox already filled with questions. So what is going to be your criteria to select the right paper? If you want to read a research paper, how will you decide? How will you select that this is the research paper I want to read? Start from scratch. Start from very basic. Assume Abhay sir and me don't know anything. Very good. Rashi says journal. Which journal? Looking at the keywords, Aisha. Fantastic. Fantastic. Yes? Come on. Impact factor. So Rashi is going to read only high impact factor because your college says only above 10, above 5, or above 20. Objective of the paper? Yes, thank you. UGC approved journals? Very much needed. Very much so that you have a high quality of content that you're referring to. Okay, I'm streaming your answers. Impact factor, objective, scientific journals, UGC approved, abstract, peer reviewed journal, discussion of the paper, Scopus indexed, find the results we want. Books, Gauri, I didn't understand your answer. Title must be appropriate. Aditi, great going. Pavan says easy language. Yes, Pavan. If it ain't simple, I don't understand. Agar simple nahi hai, sahaj nahi hai, toh main nahi seekh paunga. Very good. Vedashri, references, impactful scientific journals, fantastic. Abstract reading is pivotal. Citation, yes, Vedashri. Sumit says the abstract, fantastic. Okay, so that was my question to you. Journal of impact factor, reliable citations by reading the abstract. Thank you so much for those answers. I hope you could see from those answers that you cannot have a common way of reading research papers, the methods being involved. So what I'm going to tell you is how to read a research paper in 30 minutes and then decide whether you really want to read that paper ahead or not. I hope you could also see that with personal experience, you will design your own methodology of how to read a journal, right? You know, how to navigate and select a journal and then read it. So what I'm going to now tell you is how to read a journal in 30 minutes. Please, friends, some of you may take less than 30 minutes. Some of you may take more than 30 minutes. So just give it for yourself because we're all very different. So read the title in 1 minute, read the abstract in 10 minutes, highlight as you're reading, and quickly read the results in 10 minutes, quickly read the conclusion in 9 minutes. However, highlight as you read, this is called as annotation. Also remember that this is a very important attribute and I will come back to this in a little later. Okay, and then decide if you want to read the full paper or not. If you just read the title or you just read the abstract, that may just not be enough. So you have to touch a little upon the results and the conclusion so that you're sure that what the authors are saying in the abstract is also validated in the results and conclusions in the resonance. Okay, so what is this annotation or what is this highlighting? Right from school, all of us have this habit or practice of, using a pencil and highlighting things, we take a ruler and we underline. So whenever you are reading something, always make it a habit to underline. What happens? Whenever you are highlighting or underlining, you are essentially communicating with the text. So it helps your brain remember the text very much. Okay, I know it comes as a hard habit. Our parents have been telling us, please underline, pencil leke beto, pen and pencil leke beto. And I think even teachers in the class will say, please write down, please make notes. Half of you are daydreaming. Half of you are, looking out of the window, which crow will come, when the sparrow will go. Yes. So always make a note of what the teacher is saying or whenever you're reading something. And then what is annotation? Right? What is annotation? So what we do, I see the name of Carrie Mullis. In the margin, I absolutely immediately I put a star that this is the name of the scientist who discovered PCR. Yes, this is a biomedical application. This is an application in soil. This is an application for a particular, therapy. And then what happens? As soon as I'm flicking that book, immediately it increases the recall value of that text. So students, please remember, highlighting is underlining, and annotation is when you put a star or an asterisk sign or a plus sign, then you are actually communicating with the text and increasing the recall value. So it is going to help you tremendously. And believe me, I'm sure Abhay sir will also agree that even in meetings, even for discussions, I always ensure that my diary, is close by to me and I make a note. Of course, now you have WhatsApp, so the phone is really facilitating. But even minor points, because as soon as somebody calls up, I exactly know that these are the things that I have to ask. So always make a note, because your brain remembers better. That is the way it helps to recall the text. And essentially, like I said, it helps you communicate with the text. Okay. So going ahead from here, I'm going back to my research paper, review paper slide. So I hope you can see a review article is a club of research articles. So students, I repeat my question. What if you could read many research articles without any bias and make your own connections? What if you could link molecules and processes between papers yourself? What if you could keep all these connections for you to use when needed? Wouldn't it be great if there is a tool that helps you do this? Okay? And that tool is called as Manav, the Human Atlas Initiative. Students, faculty, and researchers can join and contribute in this project. So, as a student, you can join Manav and contribute by annotating or highlighting important information in scientific articles. So, friends, with this, I take great pride in introducing to you an esteemed project, which is a citizen science partnership funded by the Department of Biotechnology and co-funded by Persistent Systems, called Manav, the Human Atlas Initiative. It is being jointly executed by National Center for Cell Science, NCCS, Indian Institute of Science Education Research, ICER Pune, and Persistent Systems. That's our website, manav.gov.in. Now, I hope you remember that in the registration form I asked you, would you be interested in activities on the Manav desk? So, those of you who have answered yes, I will be adding your names to the database so that we can keep you informed about all our future activities. So, let me tell you more about the platform. Right now, the platform is almost ready, and in about 4 to 8 weeks, it will get launched, right? And we are going in a very systematic manner where we have downloaded more than 2 lakh papers and going organ-wise. So the first organ we have selected is skin. So we have downloaded papers that are on wide variety of subjects. I'm sure it's interesting for you to know they are on immunology, physiology, pharmacy, medicine, bioinformatics, biochemistry, and more. Okay, so as a student, you will be engaged on this platform for annotating these papers. So right now the platform is in process, and we're onboarding students for them to be part of these activities later on. Okay, so join us. Like sir rightly said, this is going to be the first priming lecture for Manav. Make a team in your college. Well, this is a teacher-led activity. So a teacher can have 3, 5, or 8 students, and they will be annotating the papers. How does the teacher help? Well, the teacher is the team leader. Some students will annotate 20%, some 40%, some 60%, and some 80%. So the teacher will help the students whose annotations are frivolous and tell them that these are not the correct annotations. They are frivolous. They are not the important ones. These are the important ones. So what will happen the next time the student is reading a research paper, his annotations will get better and better. In this manner, you will be curating and capturing scientific data from papers on the platform. Where will you be working? At your pace, in your space. That means at your speed, in your own home, on your laptop or on the computer. Maybe as things get better, you may also get allowed access for this in your college library or in your computer lab to annotate these papers. Yes, you will be receiving accolades for doing that. You may also receive a certificate saying that you have done a 6-month course on biocuration, and therefore that will help your teachers to write a recommendation for you and also for some industry to pick you up for in terms of your profile. Together, we will be creating an impact through your curation, contribution, and collaboration in the process, learning and growing. So let me tell you the objectives of this program. Just a few more slides. Thank you so much for your patience. So this aims at creation of a human atlas by assimilating all available macro and micro level information from scientific data. Well, This will provide us mechanistic knowledge ranging from intra-organ, inter-organ dependencies to tissue, cell, and subcellular level biological interactions. What's also important is it will tell us wherever there are gaps in the current biological knowledge, in areas in which future experiments can be focused to create a complete and a more accurate human representation. So like I told you, instead of going for all the organs, we are starting with the skin, and progressively we will be going to other organs. Okay, so open to students, researchers, and to academicians, faculty. So this is how our website looks like. It says a menu option of join Manav. And when you say join Manav, it will ask you whether as a student you want to join, as a faculty, as a reviewer, or as an expert reviewer. Now, faculty, you can have the dual role of being a team leader as well as a reviewer. Why? Because you will be the first person who will be seeing the annotations of a child. So you can actually tell them that these are the relevant annotations and these are not. Okay, so let me tell you this with an example. Students, are you ready? So here is my sentence. Cetrimide is a drug used for the treatment of seborrheic dermatitis. Cetrimide is a drug used for the treatment of seborrheic dermatitis. In this sentence, what will you annotate? Cetrimide is a drug used for the treatment of seborrheic dermatitis. What will you underline or annotate in the sentence? So I'm waiting for your answer. Seborrheic dermatitis, fantastic. Cetrimide, Aditi says name of the drug, name of the disease. Fantastic. Ashay, Neha, Umme, Pranali, I hope you got the answer there. Yes, the name of the drug and the disease. Okay, so I hope you can differentiate between what is general and what is content that needs to be annotated. Thank you so much. I can see, and I think all of you can see that the answers are streaming here. Everybody is so excited to, tell me what's important. Thank you. Indeed, it is the name of the disease and the name of the drug. Okay, so you just can't underline anything. It has to be very specific because that becomes specific for that paper. And what happens after you have underlined this? Yes, after you have submitted these annotations, your teacher or reviewer will be going through it, and then it will go through an expert reviewer desk. Now, these will be senior retired professionals, academicians, people who are medical practitioners, who will say that, yes, these annotations are not frivolous. They are good to go on the desk. These will be added to a vast majority of an entity list, right, which will have names of drugs, names of formulations, diseases, and back end, we will be looking at ontologies or looking for connections between these papers, processes, drugs, and molecules. Okay, so I hope you can see what an important contribution you will be making to this. So we are there on these social media handles, namely Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. The purpose is that you are a young adult population, and so we want to outreach to you. We want to reach out to you. So even if you're going to Facebook, you can check out our Facebook Manav page, and there's an interesting information there. Every Thursday, we have a data science webinar series. Okay, it's called as the DSWS series. So what happens in this DSWS series? We have people who are talking about precision cancer therapy. We have people who are talking about computational gastronomy. Did you know that the food that you eat is actually a fingerprint of all the ingredients that you are using? And there are some combination of ingredients that go very well, and there are some combination of ingredients that don't go well, right? This was a lecture by Dr. Ganesh Bagler, and believe me, you'll be amazed to listen to him. He's a physicist, an astronomy person who has gone into gastronomy. So even when you read these examples, you will realize that your future should be dictated by your interest, by your passion. So even I was not knowing, but Dr. Baliga, who's in the US, he spoke about what is cancer precision therapy, that they take the genetic map of that person. They look at the regulon, which has gone wrong, which may be a single nucleotide polymorphism or more. And then they devise drugs. Okay, this happens at Sloan Kettering Institute, where I'm sure you know everybody, a lot of people who go for their cancer treatments. It's a very high-end institute. But this is to tell you, like every week you decide, this movie you want to see, this Netflix series you want to see this Saturday. So go to our Facebook page, click on the YouTube link. It's a 45-minute module. But what will happen is it will open up an avenue for you to, whether you want to take this up as a career opportunity, there will be some learning. So you can listen to those 45-minute modules and get enriched. Okay. So I hope many of you are going to do that. So after this webinar is over, I will be generating an attendance list, and I will be sharing with you the link of two tests. Please don't worry. In this stressful situation, we are not going to stress you. We just want to know what is the level of English you understand. That means how much is your English comprehension, and were you able pay attention during the course of my lecture. Okay, please ensure these links are open for 5 days. Please ensure when you're doing the test, you do both the tests so that our system will be able to generate a certificate for you. Okay, so sign up and be a part of the Manav initiative. Yes, I have another question for you. How many research papers have you read in the lockdown period that has extended from last March to this March? How many research papers have you read that has, you know, in this lockdown period that has extended from last March to this March? Yes, and I want honest answers. Okay. So Karan says 10, Aisha says 30. That's fantastic. Somebody says 5. I'm so sure somebody has not read a single paper, but it's perfectly okay. Will you start reading now? If there's somebody who has not read a single research paper, Ume has read approximately 50. Thank you. Thank you for those answers. That really, really means so much. Okay. So here is an important resource that I'm sharing with you, which is called as signal versus noise. So we all know that there are a lot of research papers related to COVID, the COVID vaccine development, the COVID protocols, the mutant strains, the double mutant, and so on. So there's so much noise, right? There's so much noise and you can't hear anything clearly. So which are those specific signals? Which are those specific signals which tell you about what is being read by policymakers, by people who are making the vaccine, by people who are designing the therapeutic protocols, right? And that is our endeavor on Twitter, namely at SciTweet, or you can also write to us at SciTweet, SciTweet@gmail.com. Okay, with that, I come to the end of my lecture and I'm leaving the forum open for, you know, for any kind of questions. Siddhant, thank you so much. So, sir, Siddhant says he has not read any research paper, but he will start reading. Thank you so much, Siddhant. I hope my lecture has definitely got you aroused to, you know, start reading, developing a passion to read information. That's very important. You know, you should have the right content from the right place. So I'm leaving the forum open for any questions. Over to you, sir. Yeah. Thank you, Rashi. I can see your feedback. That's very kind of you. So if there are any questions, you can address it to me. Also, sometimes students, what happens, you get very overwhelmed by hearing a speaker and do din ke baad doubt aata hai. You know, after 2 days, you have a doubt. After a week, you have a doubt. So please don't worry. You can direct it either through sir or you have my email address. You can write to me. I'm typically bad on the phone. Sir knows that, but I'm quite good on email and WhatsApp. I will definitely reply back to you. So if you have any questions, I will be very happy to answer. And I think in the chat window, there were some previous questions. So I'm just trying to fish them out. If I have not answered your question, can you just repeat your question? Just looking for the questions. Yes, Aisha, you have got it correct. So Aisha is going to get the gift hamper. So Aisha, this is correct. This is called as biocuration. Thank you so much that my lecture could tell you what is a biocurator. And they play a very important role in you know, creating ontogenic maps. You know, which is beyond a review paper, so something that's very, very good career option. So I'm hoping a lot of you will consider. And you are at an advantage, you know, being pharmacy students, you know a little bit of medicine, you know a little bit of biochemistry, you know microbiology, and you know pharmacy. So believe me, that's a deadly combination. Because when I was doing my PhD, I had to learn pharmacy, I had to learn bioinformatics, I had to learn many other subjects. So I always feel pharmacy graduates are at a great advantage. Okay, so. Yeah, so I'm just looking for the questions that were there in the chat window. Can you just repeat your questions? If there's anybody who has put a question in the chat window that I've not answered, I think in the beginning they were there. Let me just check again. Yeah. Okay, I'm just leaving my email ID just in case you didn't have it, so that you can pick up my email ID in case there's any doubt. If there are any questions, you can just voice it out to me. Yeah. And towards the end, I'm going to request everybody to also put on their videos for a photograph. Nevertheless, yeah, over to you, sir. I'm just screening for the questions if they were there. Yeah.
I can start. I have a question.
Oh, sure, sir.
Okay. You said the portal is going to get open in a couple of weeks, right? Or 2-3 weeks, whatever you say.
Yeah.
it so that the curated information is to be submitted onto the onto that portal, right? So which is supposed to be there.
Okay, I'll just help you understand this better. So the portal will open in the next few weeks, assume 2 months. Okay, once the portal opens, then we will have let's say Abhay sir has his own team of 10 students. Okay, so 10 students will be then given research papers which they will annotate. You will review the annotations and they will submit it back to the platform. So this is what the portal is going to be open for, where the students are going to be annotating at their pace in their space. Now this can be done by 10 teachers in your college, it can be done by 15, or it can be done by 5 teachers. And we're trying to make it very user friendly so that as a teacher, we understand you have academic duties. So we don't want you to feel bogged down, so that quickly you can go through the annotations and says, yeah, okay, go for submission. And then back end, we are having strong systems where we will be doing a system check, as well as we will be having a human touch, you know, where the person will be going through the annotations and then submitting it onto the platform. After about 6 months, all these annotations will be available freely on a public database to all students, researchers, and teachers. Okay, so what will happen is, instead of reading a paper, they will actually look at the annotations that will help them better to understand a particular correlation, to understand a drug effect, and to, you know, then derive their correlations. Yeah, so this is how the process is going to be. So I hope I have been able to answer your question, sir.
Yes.
So good, madam. It's a very good talk, and you are all-rounder personality, as I said. You have the knowledge from, not information, knowledge from the various fields, and you are
Thank you, sir.
I will be happy to see you in our campus after pandemic. And we'll have the very good association with you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'm just still looking for any questions if they are there. If there are not many questions, can I request everybody to just put on their video for a minute? One second. There is a question from Akshada. How to distill out key out of information from any research paper? Akshada, is that question still standing, or have I been able to answer that in my talk? I will just wait for her to respond in the chat. If there are any other questions, I'm still leaving the forum open. Yeah, and another doubt that I can clear here, right now the platform is open only for biological science students, although the principal scientific advisor did want it to be open for all subjects, but I'm sure you understand it's an arduous task to get all students to annotate in all subjects. So we are beginning with biological sciences, and if the project goes well, we will definitely be extending it to other subjects also, because a lot of students in physics, chemistry, and maths will feel very left out that biological science subjects are understanding biocuration. I'm sure they also want to indulge in something what is data curation. So I'm so sorry, but right now we are going very in a very phase-wise manner. And Dr. Abhay Jire is a very active and coercive person who says that don't give me students from Pune, don't give me students from Bombay, give me students from Deulgaon, give me students from Satara, give me students from the Northeast. So I hope you understand that it's a big privilege, you know, where as students, as citizens, we are going to be able to participate, and all our annotations are going to be available on a database. Thank you so much for obliging me for a photograph. I will just take a picture, and then we are good to go to answer Akshada's answer.
Madam, Abhay is a very good associate of our college.
That's amazing. He's a wonderful person and very down to earth. I can tell you, in meetings, it's such a wonderful thing to interact with him. मीटिंग मध्ये दिल्लीच्या मीटिंग मध्ये असताना ते मराठीत बोलणार, अनुपमा मला ते त्या गावाचं काय झालं, साताराला लातूरला ते स्टेशन झालंय का नाही. सो व्हेरी व्हेरी अमेझिंग पर्सन. आय थिंक एज अ रिसोर्स पर्सन ऑल्सो वी शुड अंडरस्टँड, ऑर एज अ टीचर, एज अ स्टुडंट, द मोर लर्नेड वी बिकम, द मोर हम्बल वी गेट. द वे ही टॉक्स, द वे ही पुट्स हिज आयडियाज, अँड ऑल दीज हॅकथॉन्स कम फ्रॉम हिज डेस्क. सो आय एम शुअर यू कॅन इमॅजिन वॉट काइंड ऑफ बँडविड्थ गोज इन टू यु नो पुटिंग देम टुगेदर. थँक यू व्हेरी मच ऑल ऑफ यू.
Pokarkar madam to add something. So she is heading our research unit or the committee. Okay. In the college also.
Okay.
Pokarkar. Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Pawar sir. I was actually going to speak something, but since Dr. Anupama was in the process of taking the picture, I thought I will wait for your comments together. So first of all, Dr. Anupama, thank you very much for that excellent talk. And I'm sure that it has certainly aroused the interest of all the students who have joined here. But I'm sure there will be more who would get interested by, you know, understanding or, you know, learning it from their friends who have joined. And they would certainly add up, you know, in this whole program. So thank you very much. Your talk was extremely interesting. And yes, we are very active in terms of research, as Dr. Pawar has rightly pointed out. So we have a very vibrant research group, the faculty members, as well as the teachers, the postgraduate research, as well as the PhD research scholars. So we have certainly a very vibrant group. And also our undergraduate students are also equally interested and active, although they are not able to do any laboratory-based research project, and especially because of this pandemic situation. But yes, they do undertake a project as a part of their undergrad program, wherein they do a literature or a review-based, you know, project. So this certainly is going to help them. And as you can see, that many have pointed out that they have got, although they may not have read any research article till date, because of your talk, I'm sure they have got interested into it. And I really thank you for that. And we will provide you all the support that is required from Pune College of Pharmacy to be a part of this program. So thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for the kind words. Yeah. Okay, so Akshata has said how to distill out keywords from a research paper. Well, Akshata, I'm going to try to answer that question. There's no uniform answer for it, nevertheless. So when you are reading a research paper, whatever are the important points, okay? Like, for example, I'll just tell you from my experience, any new technique, any new protocol that has been used, the model system that has been used, right? What methodology they have used. So like, for example, if you're doing protein estimation, have they used a Bradford's assay or a Follin-Lowry assay, or so the name of the assay. So this is how you will, you know, pick out important points from a research paper, and that's how you will get, you know, your keywords. Now, out of this, some will be related to methodology, some will be related to research, and some may be related to the findings of that experiment. Okay, so Akshata, I hope I have been able to answer your question with that.